Thank you all for coming. Thank you so much, Mumbai Festival friends. Thank you so much, Mumbai Local, for giving me this really special opportunity to reflect and to share something of my journeys, not just with Kabir, but I took this opportunity to look back and reflect on what came before, the journey of my life, in a sense. And as I started planning this talk, I found myself revisiting that moment. For those of you who've seen one of my Kabir films, Had Anhad, the famous moment when a Sufi Kawwal in Karachi asked me three questions that Sufism asks you. आप कहाँ से आए हैं, आप कौन हैं और आप कहाँ जा रहे हैं? Where have you come from, who are you and where are you going? Kabir echoes this in a beautiful bhajan that Prahlad ji sings, we've all heard. कहाँ से आया, कहाँ जाओगे, खबर करो अपने तन की. So I thought, okay, let me ask myself these three questions today in the light of whatever has passed. And I found myself going back way before the Kabir journeys to my childhood, actually, to growing up in a post-partition Punjabi household with an Indian Air Force pilot as a dad who breathed music into my life. And my bua is sitting here, so I'm already getting emotional. So I found myself going back to growing up in the 70s and the 80s, you know, those heady days of early feminism in this country, when the first protests, and we are seeing many protests today, and I'm so happy for that, but those were the days of early feminism, when the first protests against rape and patriarchy were being born on the streets of this country. And I found myself going back to being a journalist in Jaipur with the Times of India, reporting on things that brought religion, gender, and society together, like the sati that took place in Deorala, Rajasthan, which I reported on as a journalist. Going back to all my years of working with rural women activists, rural women mobilizing, protesting the structures of society that kept us in the home, that told us that finding a man and marriage is the destiny of your life, questioning all that, and trying to find new identities for ourselves. And then, of course, going back to post-Godhra riots in Ahmedabad and the arrival of Kabir in my life and my questing for Kabir to ask, to find answers to questions of fundamental questions which we are asking ourselves again today, aren't we? Why is there so much hatred? Why is there so much divisiveness in this world? And these journeys took the shape of films, CDs, working with folk singers, curating their music, festivals, yatras, a web archive, some books which I will read to you from today, which are also available here. And so this evening I will just share a few snippets from some films, a few songs, and some reflections. So I tried to look under the surface of all these events to probe what was the undercurrent that was driving me, and asked myself this question, where am I coming from? This first question, where am I coming from? And unexpectedly, a very, very old memory popped into my head, which I thought I will share with you. I was in my 20s, and I was in a second-class train compartment going from Ahmedabad to a remote village in Madhya Pradesh called Tilda, also in Malwa, significantly. And as happens in second-class train compartments, the windows breathe. You can look out. and you see the rolling, undulating landscape of green fields, and the train is so slow that you can actually pass by and hear cattle herds and their bells tinkling in the distance, and everybody's going about their business. And suddenly, a blind beggar came into the coach and started singing. Ae dur ke musafir. It's an old Hindi film song. Humko bhi saath le le re. Humko bhi saath le le. Hum reh gaye akele. And I don't know what happened. I don't know what happened to me, but the way that song kind of pierced into my soul. I didn't have the vocabulary then, but now 25 years later, I think I know what it was. I recognize it today for being a shabd ki chot, you know, a wound of the word. Because this is a wound that only a song, a sound, a word can deliver. Because it's only the call of a song that pierces through all your mental categories and posturings and defenses and conscious contrivances, all the things, all the baggage that we create about how we want to be in this world. It pierces right through and cuts to some trembling core of truth inside of you, which you want to tuck away. Don't really want to look at too closely. And I really don't know what happened. I was in a state after that experience of listening to that blind beggar singing that song for almost 2-3 weeks after that. It felt like an out-of-body experience. And looking back, I see why. A, it was a song. It was a folk song. It was a folk voice. It was raw, honest, uncontrived, just what it is. It was vulnerable, because here was a blind man, to boot, a beggar. Many of us don't like to think of ourselves as beggars, do we? But there is a vulnerability in all of us. Ultimately, we're all beggars for love, maybe, yeah? So, the song was about being left alone. And I had already by then had a taste of, my first taste of love and loss. I think I was 11 when I lost my father to an air crash. And I heard that vulnerability in that beggar's voice, that vulnerability that you feel when you are confronted by the awesome, almost callous force of nature, when it follows its only truth, which is change, movement, life and death. That vulnerability, I heard. And much before I lost my father at the age of 11, I remember even as early as being 6 or 7 years old, I would often be beset by, despite growing up in a very happy family, there was no discord in the family, I had an idyllic family life. But I would be beset with a feeling of being adrift in the cosmos, bereft, completely cut off, disconnected from any warmth, floating. The blind beggar I see today, I understand today, had touched, stirred up those primal chords in me. And those primal chords were of separation, of bereavement, of disconnection, of abandonment, of being left alone. and with it, primal needs. A longing for love, a longing for togetherness. So, love, such a difficult word to live up to, right? Because fractures and ruptures erupt all too soon in hearts, in egos, in partners, in families, in communities, in neighborhoods, across nations. We see it right now, all around us, most frequently perhaps. So there is a longing for belonging, if you will. And I'm going to now show you, having given you a glimpse of my personal journey and an experience of trying to answer this question, where have I come from? I'm going to show you a clip of a video film from one of the four Kabir films I made called Kabira Khada. In this moment, I'm with Prahlad Tipanyaji, who's a guru to me, a wonderful folk singer whom many of you know. We have visited a place called Chhattisgarh to a place where the Kabir Panth Mela is happening. About 2 lakh Kabir Panthis have gathered here in this small town, small village, I should say. And they are seeking belonging here. Many of them are what we call lower castes in this country. Many of them are tribals. You will see some wearing outlandish tribal outfits in that mela. And everybody is seeking belonging.
मेला हुआ है हर साल तो मेला देखते हैं उम्र हो गया है 60 साल साले हम मान लो 2-4 साल कबीर को दे दिए 2-4 साल विवेकानंद को दे दिए 2-4 साल गायत्री परिवार को दे दिए और तो यहां तो इसी में हमारा जिंदगी खा गए यार तुम लोग हमको रास्ता कहां मुकाम कहां पहुंचाए
हां
अरे भाई गारंटी दो ना कि हम आपको मुकाम पहुंचाएंगे तुम करना का तो जा है ना
सही बात
कब तक के गुरु गुरु करके घूमते रहेंगे पीछे पीछे साले है ना और किसके किसके पीछे गुरु जब आप कहीं पर भी संप्रदाय फिर का मतलब कहीं पर भी सुनने के लिए जाते हैं तो यही कहते हैं भैया कि इसको हम पा जाएं एक बार चाहे कबीर के माध्यम से पाए चाहे किसी भी संत के पीछे हमारे यहाँ कोई कमी तो है नहीं हर दृष्टि से भरपूर है हमारा राष्ट्र इस मामला में भाई तो पहुंचाओ तो दादा
थारो धर्म संघाती रेला आरो मार्ग माथे रे लार सोदागिर अब क्यों भूल्यो जाए रे थारो धर्म संगाती रे लार थारो मार्ग मा तेरे लार सौदागिर अब क्यों भूलो जाए रे। अरे हाटा रे हाटा लोबी थे फरिया रे लोबी मैं तो फिरी थारी लार। अरे हाटा रे हाटा लोबी थे फरिया रे लोबी मैं तो फिरी थारी लार। अब सुगरा मानस सौदा करी चल्या रे लोभी नुगरा तो मूले गमाय सौदागिर अब क्यों भूलो जाए रे। सौदागिर अब क्यों भूलो जाए रे। थारो धर्म संगाती रे लार थारो मार्ग मा तेरे लार सौदागिर अब मत भूलो जाए रे सौदागिर।
So I wanted to show this clip because I feel it captures this feeling, this recognition, like all those Kabirpanthi devotees doing an aarti to Kabir in the first sequence. There's this woman with trembling hands, deeply in need there, hoping for some solace in that space. The man, the funny man in the bus, the wisdom that comes from the Indian streets, from ordinary people, saying, "Pahunchao to data, who's going to get me there?" The dancing tribals. To me, it all comes together as a recognition of the fact that there is a deep core, original tear, a rent, a separation from an origin. And we keep trying to put band-aids on that core wound. Band-aids, because I call them band-aids, the Sufi, the mystic will call them band-aids, because it doesn't do the job. And what are those band-aids? Lovers, family, bete, betiyan, job, profession, community, caste, belonging to groups, nations, identities. We keep trying to repair that original wound of separation, and it doesn't work. Because everything that you're grasping to, even as you're holding on to it, it's slipping through your fingers, isn't it? So the Sufi, the mystic, will keep asking you to connect with that original thirst, not lose sight of it. Ask you to remember where you came from. Shah Abdul Latif Bhetai in Sindhi translation says, "The jungle of desires is raised to a field of ash. Thieves scatter, scrambling for cover. The thirsty meets her thirst face to face for the first time ever." I will tell you a story from Shah Abdul Latif Bhetai, the story of Marui and Umar, because if we are seeking to remember where we came from, what better story to tell you than the story of Marui? Marui, who was the simple Rabadi girl who lived in a village called Malir. One day, a king from a neighboring kingdom, Umar, hearing about Marui's beauty, came searching for her, asked her for some water, she gave it to him. He kidnapped her and took her back with him to his palace and said, "I love you, you can be my chief queen." And Marui said, but no, I want to go back to my simple life with my Ribari Madus in Malir. I don't want this. So he tried threats, he tried bribes, nothing worked. So he imprisoned her in a fortress. For decades and decades, Marui lived in that fortress, imprisoned, but refusing to forget where she came from. She refused to give in to Umar. And after many long years, she gets returned. But that's not important for Shah Latif or for us. In the poetic imagination of Shah Latif, this fortress is our body. This soul is Marui, the Ruh, that never forgets where she came from, which is Malir, her homeland. Umar, interestingly, is Marui's own nafs, Marui's ego that will mind, ego mind, that will try and lure Marui into entanglements with the world. These kind of entanglements. Garv se kaho hum ye hain, hum wo hain. These are entanglements. This is forgetting who we are, where we've come from. And Marui is an exemplary ruh, because she never forgets where she comes from. The simplicity, the frugality, the nakedness even of her origins. And that's what her homeland begins to mean to her. There is a creation myth in Islam which says that when Rabb created the world, kun fayakun, he said, be and it was. He sent all the ruhs to earth and said before they left, don't ever forget who your true beloved is. Me. And they made him that promise. We all made him that promise, or her that promise. But we came here and we forgot. And we took many lovers. Marui never forgets where she came from. So I'll read a few poems to you from Marui. Am I not your truest love? Hearing those words, I answered yes. In that instant, my heart was pledged to him. No call to be had rung out then, no ether, no flesh, no Adam, no form. It was then, in that moment, that I met with you, my Lord. No call to be had rung out then, no moon, no sun, no virtue, no sin, just one, only one. It was then, says Latif, that Allah unfurled the riddle. I grasped the mystery. I saw, I felt his presence. Destiny captivated me. Why else would I be here? Fate brought me to this place, but heart, body, breath belong to them. O King, let Marui return to her people. I'll wreck this palace of delights. Bereft of my kin, I'll burn it to cinders. All things return to their origin. So I long to return. I'll set eyes on Malir again. My homeland calls. Kabir speaks in a bhajan to Gorakhnath, Tu kab ka bhaya bairagi? And he will answer, Main tab ka bhaya bairagi? When there was no earth, no sky, nothing. All spiritual traditions keep inviting us to hark back to this origin, this place when we were untainted, we were Niranjan, before we got entangled in things we began to take too seriously. So I'll sing for you now a Meera Bhajan, which I've learned from another wonderful folk singer called Mahesh Aramji from Rajasthan. Beeni chhod bed bheera. Beeni is pulse. Bed, ved, doctor. Veera, brother. Mujhe peeda nyari hai. Just let go of my pulse, you silly doctor. Because my pain comes from somewhere else. बीनी को तू भेद ना जाने, तू तो बड़ो अनाड़ी है. You're a quack. You don't get it. You don't get the secret of this pain. This pain. आंगलियारी अनेक रेखा, कर्म रेखा न्यारी है. There are many fate lines here, but I wrote one too. दांतारी बत्री सी कान्हा, सोना में खमारी है. There are 32 teeth you are given, but I engraved a dot of gold on them. पाना जैसी पिवड़ी भई, पलंग पर पोढ़ारी है. I've grown as thin as a leaf. विरहरी कटारी कान्हा, ऊर बिच मारी है. कान्हा हरी has struck me in the heart with a dagger of separation. गोकुला में बसे कान हो, उससे मेरी यारी है. उसी को बुलाए के वो ही वेद भारी है. जमुना में नाग नाच्यो, सें सें कलाधारी है. दीज आर ऑल दी एंटेंगलमेंट्स. दैट इज व्हाट द नाग इज. बाई मीरा लाल गिरधर, चरणों की बलिहारी है. Interestingly, I find this poem in Shalatif. Like a reed shrieks when cut, I howl, sundered from my love. Why brand my arm, doctor? The pain is in my heart.
बीने छोड़ दे दो तेरा मुझे पीड़ा.
कर्म रेखा न्यारी आंगड़ियारी अनेक रेखा कर्म रेखा न्यारी है ताकारी बात this question, where did I come from? I came to understand the power of viraha. We have such a vast tradition of viraha in this country, not just in the voice of Meera, but in voice of Kabir. Shah Latif is full of viraha. And Kabir says at one place, viraha ko bura mat kaho, viraha hai sultan. Jaghat viraha na sanchare vaghat jaan smashan. So you have to, when you feel this pain, you have to honor it. It's not, oh, I'm such a loser. No. Birha jagave darad ko, darad jagave jeev, jeev jagave surat ko, surat jagave piu. This is the path of pain. So we have to honor this dard, this viraha, this pain, because that is going to awaken us to the beloved. Second question, who am I? Aap kaun hai? And there were two very difficult lessons in store for me in these journeys. One was from Meera herself. Let's take this song. Meera certainly had her nadi on my pulse, her hand on my nadi. by speaking of that Nyari Pida. I related with that. But back then in the 20s and 30s, when I was 20s, in my 20s and 30s, this Charano Ki Balihari business didn't quite work for me. Are there some women in the audience here who relate with that? Yeah? Yeah? Like what? Submission at the feet of a male god? No ways. You know, here we were rallying as women for change in society, as feminists. We were asserting choice. We were asserting control. It was all about making choices and gaining control over our lives. And what is this submission at the feet of a male lord? The politics didn't work for me. And then life happened, you know. In the interim, life happened. And I think I'm still struggling to learn this lesson, which is to not confuse surrender with submission, to not confuse vulnerability with weakness, to in fact realize that when you surrender to something vaster than yourself, with utter abdication of will, something infinitely vaster than yourself, you gain incredible strength. You don't become weak. That surrender gives you incredible strength to wage your wars of resistance in this world. Because Meera walked out on a patriarchal palace, right? She had no problems doing that. Her surrender didn't make her weak. The Rana Sanghas were easy victories for Meera. The bigger battle she was fighting in here. And she was winning that battle and winning Hari through surrender. That's a difficult lesson. To know that resistance and surrender can go together. It's not a paradox. It's not a contradiction. They are held together. The second lesson, who am I, came from all of them, Kabir, Sufis, mystics, which is that we grow up, we are acculturated into consolidating ourselves, shoring up our identity, building our identity. And Kabir is saying, break it down, let it dissolve, give it away, let it go. We are building our homes for security and belonging. Kabir is saying, burn your homes. Let go. There's an infinite wisdom in letting go of these identities we cling to, which lead to divisions and wars and violence. So I'm still struggling to learn that lesson. And now I'm going to just not sing you a whole song, but I'm going to sing you, well, maybe I won't sing you that song. Is it already 6:20? Oops. Okay, I'm just going to sing the first line. How difficult is this? Kabira khada bazar mein liye lukathi haath jo ghar ja re apna chale hamare saath. How easy is this to burn the house we cling to, our self image, our identity, our assets, are people whom we cling to and make life miserable for them. And also Kabir says, Kabira khada bazar mein mange sab ki khair, na kahu se dosti, na kahu se bair. How easy is that? To be in resistance, to struggle, to stand up for what is wrong, and yet have a nirbhayar quality. How easy is that? Okay. Just half a song. What an irony for this, the political times our country is facing right now, that this should be described as Ram Ras. This quality of letting go, of giving up, of surrendering, this strength, this taste is called Ram Ras, not what is unfolding, where we grab and claim and divide. Last question, where am I going? That should be a no-brainer for anybody who's had any brush with Kabir and the mystics and the Sufis. Where are all things going? To death, right? Into a void. Where else are we going? And this also came as a very interesting challenge for me back then, because I had been nourished and nurtured, I still am, with songs like, I made a whole film based on this song, and we hear it now in Shaheen Bagh being sung by women pitching camp there. Tu zinda hai, tu zindagi ki jeet pe yakeen kar, agar kahin hai swarg to utar la zameen par. Tu zinda hai. हजार भेष धर के आई मौत तेरे द्वार पर, मगर तुझे न छल सकी चली गई वो हार कर. This is what nourished me in my 20s and 30s, and then pala pada Kabir se, who would never let me forget the reality of death and the fact that you will bow your head to death. And it's been a piquant lesson again to realize that death is not despondency, death is not defeat. Death is indeed life itself, actually, no? Because if you really confront the real, actually I would say that the biggest spiritual teacher for Kabir and all of us through him is death, because it's only death that releases us into being able to not take ourselves so seriously and to then begin to play this game like a this life like a game. We get released into a sense of humor, you know. We become less long-faced and serious about everything that we think is ours, that defines us, you know. Then we can relax. So, this was the last lesson and the last question, where am I going? And a while back, I was from the depths of pain, we all have pain, in a particular moment of pain in my life, I found myself writing these words. And I'm really happy to see that I recognize here in the depths of my pain a sliver of play, delight, sport. So I feel a little less worried about myself. I feel I've maybe learned a few lessons. Anyway, the pain was intense, and I found myself writing, "Pain tumbles and billows into rain clouds. Memories crack them open, roaring a din of unbelonging. Would that I could swirl without gravity, gently bump others in delight, and go careening into space at home with the stars." And to make a home with the stars, to make a home in the sky, actually, is a lesson I've learned from Kabir. Because in answering the question, who am I, Kabir says, "Jat hamari atma, pran hamara naam, alak hamara isht hai, gagan hamara gam." You know? Do we need a translation, anyone? Don't be shy. Okay. Yes. My caste is my soul, my name, my breath, my life force. My deity, my beloved, is the alak, that which cannot be seen or shown. And my native place, my home, is in the sky. Kabir will ask us to draw inspiration from the phoenix bird, the legendary phoenix, the Anal Pakshi, which is supposed to live only in the sky, never alight. It even lays its eggs in the air, and it cracks mid-air, and from it the new phoenix bird is born. So Kabir will say, "Anal akasa ghar kiya madhya nirantar vas vasudha vyom birkat rahe bina thor vishwas." I just love that phrase, bina thor vishwas. Do you have the courage? Do you have the faith in anchorlessness? In being anchorless, bina thor vishwas, Kabir ko hai wo vishwas, to be there, to burn his house, to cut off his head. So we'll end with a film clip, a poem, and a song. This film clip I want to show because here's a woman I met in the streets of Devas, a fruit seller, Kashiba. And she is also going to sing a song that harks back to the beginning of this talk. A sense of being left alone and inviting and telling that musafir, don't leave me alone. Ram, she's telling Ram, don't leave me alone. But see how she sings it and says it.
Marikaya ra kare tal rama ab ke mosar la ra lai chalo o gore bap ji gagan mandal jhulo bandiyo o gore ab ye jhule mara sri bhagwan rama sangri sayelya jula de rahi agare mari mala ramani yaad rama chodi mat ja jo ban mein ekli agare mari kaya ira kari gar rama ab ke musare lara lai chalo bap ji banate machindar gorak boliya o gore ab ye paya ge bekunte bas rama ab ke mosare lara lai chalo ये जाता है नी जब पांच तत्व होती है के माला रमणिया छोड़ी मत जाओ बन में एक काया रहा करता रब के मौसला रहा नहीं चलो तो कहीं क्यों ने कहीं क्यों भगवान ने जब ये बोले है नी इसने किया ये डूंगा बेल है इसने किया के देख जिसने जोड़ी उसने तोड़ी मैं क्या जानू मैं तो ये जाता इस मकान में निवास किया मैंने इसको ही छोड़ जाता इस मकान की भी छोड़ जाए ना ये ले अब ये निकली जाए ना या तू अब ये मकान डल दिया है अब यो या कुटड़िया इसके लिए ये घर मथन करते हैं है? ये नहीं होते इसके क्या रोए काय के माथा फोड़ कर आई ये काय लो माथा फोड़ कर आई सब पेट के लिए दौड़ते हैं माँ चुटाते हैं दादा हम तो सही से कहती हूँ अच्छा झूठ बचाने में
100%
जब क्यों भाई अब ये तो करनी आना सा देखो भैया जी करनी करोगे सब पारो तो ये करने ही करे तो क्यों डरे ने करके क्यों पछता अरे बोया पेड़ बहुल का तो आम कहाँ से खुल गया बाजारे की मार अड़जियो पर मगर खुल गया बाजारे की मार ले ताला खुल गया ये बींजन सारी का बोलिया बोलिया दोरू ने पेड़ा दर्जियो पर मगर बोलिया बोलिया दोरू ने पेड़ा दे जुग जुग सरना का मैं दास ने
So I wanted to show this because I wanted to show how a true encounter with the recognition, irreversible recognition of death, can release you. You can feel this. It's not a cerebral insight for this lady. It's in her bones, it's in her body language, that freedom that she has because she has confronted the perishability of everything. And it has released in her what? A sense of humor. A sense of play, an irreverence, and most of all, the locks on her heart have sprung open. It's only this that will release us from our pettiness, from our border making, from our divisions. Death will show us how to love each other, truly love each other. I want to share with you a poem by Pablo Neruda. Because somehow it speaks to me as the start of these journeys, and it ties up with why I chose to call this talk The Call of a Song or The Call of a Poem, because in this, Neruda speaks of poetry and what poetry means to him. And I know that in Ahmedabad post-Godhra riots, Kabir's voice called out to me, calling out to me in a sort of similar way. And it was at that age poetry arrived in search of me. I don't know where it came from winter or a river. I don't know how or when. No, they were not voices. They were not words nor silence. But from a street I was summoned. From the branches of night, abruptly from the others, among violent fires, or returning alone, there I was without a face, and it touched me. And I, infinitesimal being, drunk with the great starry void, likeness, image of mystery, felt myself a pure part of the abyss. I wheeled with the stars. My heart broke loose with the wind. The poem, the song, the story, they give us solace. They also give us flight. But only if we are able to hear their call, only if we can be empty, without a face, as Neruda says, drunk on the great starry void. Because if we bring our baggage to the moment of reading a poem or hearing a poem or hearing a song, it's lost on you. It's like water on a duck's back. Can we be without a face when we hear the song, the poem? But we live in prosaic times, don't we? Where everything is spelt out, defined, identified. Identities scream at us from newspapers, hoardings, shrines. We live in a flat and two-dimensional world. Neruda and Kabir and the mystics and Latif, they show us the joys of being without a face, of getting drunk on the void, of emptiness, on the freedom of the sky. So we started this talk asking the question, touching the cord of separation, of partition, of being rent asunder from some source. And I want to end this talk by sharing with you a song by a Pakistani poet called Sheikh Ayaz from across the border, where he says in Sindhi, Kade mildasi, when shall we meet? Tiri ponda tariyen, jade gaada gul alala, tade mildasi. Tade mildasi meaning tab milenge. Kab? Jab un daliyon pe surkh phool khilenge, tab hum milenge. Aur ye kaun sa milan? What milan are we speaking about? A meeting with each other. A meeting between self and other, people we have othered. This is a meeting between us and Musalman, Hindu Musalman. It is a meeting between India and Pakistan. It's a meeting between straight and gay. It's a meeting between all the various ways in which we create divisions, borders, and separations in these xenophobic times. This is the meeting we are speaking of here. This is not some fluffy romantic meeting with some beloved and we feel good sitting in satsang. No, it is about how we choose to live our lives with our neighbors. Let's talk about those meetings. These are not some elevated, cotton-headed abstract ideas. These are real questions. This is a meeting between me and myself. My vast self, because my vast self is whole. It contains all this diversity, and I embrace it. And like Kabir, I say, I am in all are in me. Hum sab mai, sab hum mai, hum hai bahuri akela. Kade mildasi? Jade varandiyun, kunjadiyun, har har kare, hul alala, tade mildasi. When those saras cranes sweep around in grand turns, returning on their migratory path, calling out, hara, 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 making that halla, hul alala, then we shall meet. Gallan nagoda trimanda, jade motin tul alala, tade mildansi. When these tears flowing down my cheeks turn to pearls, get the value of being honored. This pain, this dard, gets honored as a pearl. Tade mildasi. Vichhode ja dihada, bhorai ji bhul alala, tade mildasi. When these days of separation, bichhadne ke ye din, bhole pan ki bhool hai, jab hum ye kubool karenge, tab hum milenge. When we realize the nadanpan, the folly of inexperience, immaturity, of not knowing that I am one with that which I think I'm separated from, then we shall meet. Tere paunda tari jada gaada tere paunda जगह है लाला तड़े तड़े So here's an informed satsangi. Chintan worked with us for 2 years, and when he left, he missed the satsang so badly, he used to WhatsApp us. Farmaish is sitting in Bombay. Ke yaar, mere naam pe ye ga dena. So I think maybe we can end with that song, but I would really like for us to have a conversation. Mic is not on. Yeah, now it's on.
Hello. Yeah. So, like, our first encounter with Kabir was in our syllabus. We, like, all my generation people can relate to it. We used to have Kabir's Doha in our syllabus. So that is our first encounter. I guess my generation can relate to it. So I love this concept about the I don't think it's his concept, but this thing about Agun Nirakar God, where all our souls go meet to him, and that is the destination, like that is the goal of all our souls. So when we look at all the saints, like Mirabai, for instance, or Kabir, they are like quite readily, like, you know, they are quite ready to die because their ultimate goal is to go meet the God over there. So I just wanted to know that then why do people make sense out of life? Like if that is what they're promoting, like they are promoting death a lot. So like what,
okay.
How will you like?
Okay, there's a very simple answer to that. When Meera and Kabir speak about death, they're not talking about physical death. Period. Let's get that out of the way. They're speaking about perishability of things you are clinging to. And we are born and we die 1,000 times every day because we cling, we are drawn, we are attracted, we identify, we hoard, we possess. That is all birth. And it's taken away from us by enemies, by borders, by, I don't know, earthquakes, by death, by misunderstandings. These things go away, and that's death. So when they are saying, recognize death, and in the moment of death, in the moment of recognizing that everything you are attaching yourself to is going to go, or is going right now, you will be free. And then you might be released into love. You might get freed into relating with all these very same things with delight, appreciation, non-consumptive appreciation, which is life. So these poets are not turning their backs on life at all. In fact, there is a doha by Kabir where he says that, you know, if Ram, you will come and meet me when this body turns cold, what use is that milan? Don't want it. Now.
Thank you so much for such a wonderful session. And more than that, I listen to you on YouTube, especially when I'm doing something. And that's the time when I'm in satsang. Maybe you're not aware, but that's my time of, you know, satsang. When I'm doing something and in background, there's Kabir Bhajan happening. The question is then, you also have life and you have your karmas and you get into work. How do you keep this satsang revolving? The satsang is so important because it changes the context, the place where you're coming from and going to, which we had this whole conversation about. And you lose satsang because you're into maya, vasna, and more other things. So how to, like, you know, maybe be in that satsang forever?
Yeah, it's not easy, no? Yeah. But I'm afraid there is no shortcut. The answer is to be, as Kabir says in one song from Rajasthan, Aathon peher hoshiyar ji. Suli upar ghar hamara. आठों पहर होशियार जी संत कबीर रमी गयो पायो समथिंग आठों पहर होशियार या सो कबीर इज एट प्ले एट ऑल मोमेंट्स ऑफ द डे अवेयर ही इज नॉट रिट्रीटिंग इन टू सत्संग. There's another famous poem of Kabir's where he's saying, Utte meditation, baithte samadhi, khate samadhi, sote samadhi. You have to bring this quality, this wisdom into every living moment. Every interaction of yours, you have to be aware. Which is why he will say, Ek dal do panchi baitha, ek guru ek chela. Chela reha, so ras chun khaya, guru nirantar khela. Again, play. You know, this is a big theme in Kabir. Play, ramna, khelna. And who are those two birds on that tree? Both are you. One is the you who is going about in the maya of this world. And the other guru is also you who is watching. And, you know, saying, as a Buddhist teacher I just heard 2 weeks ago said, whatever, you know. That's the spirit of the guru who has that capacity to say, whatever. You know that lightness, the humor implicit in that? That is the guru in you who's not getting all, you know, like that. The guru in you is unclenching. the chela is always clenching. The guru unclenches for you.
Hi. Hello. Yeah, hi. Thank you so much for today. See, I have heard of Kabir like since I was young, but never understood. Of course, I don't understand still. We saw that clip with that fruit seller lady. Maybe she understood more than me, but I don't think she must have read anything. She has lived her life and that has like come to her. Where should we start? Where should I start?
So, you know, there is a vast oral tradition of Kabir in this country. And luckily for you, you have the Mumbai Festival of Kabir happening here every year. You have a lot of this online. You have so many wonderful singers of Kabir. You have... So I'm not saying don't read. Read Kabir. I started by reading Kabir before I set out and discovered the incredible diversity of music and song in Kabir. But you have to find pause. Poetry cannot be fitted into a busy schedule. You have to make yourself vulnerable. You have to pause. You have to reflect. You have to breathe, and then the poem, the song will hit you. And you have to allow that chot to happen. You have to be vulnerable. And you have being vulnerable means allowing yourself to become who you weren't a minute ago. Allowing that transformation, allowing that house to burn. Then Kabir will start speaking to you.
Shabnam, I have a question.
Yes.
So often when we think of these mystic poets or many of the spirit people who end up becoming spiritual leaders, we don't often look at them in historical context. So when you talk about a Kabir or a Mirabai or whatever, one of the things that I feel often gets missed out is in a sense how anti-establishment and rebellious
they were.
At least they were, right? And I wonder if you could talk a little bit about that. And does it come through in the music? Does it come through in the poetry? How does that come through at all? Like, how does that all come together? Because sometimes I feel we talk about the individual as separate from these social things that happen, you know?
So, okay, there are many things you have said there. I don't know where to start. Let me start with the last thing you said. You know, you said, I think things tend to get individualized. Rather than, say, if we brought a gaze of social change that came from a more structural analysis of society, we might say change is possible only through collectives, right? Or larger institutions. Or that's true, but I think Kabir will insist on an individual path. Kabir was not interested in group formations for change. Kabir did not start the panth. And in fact, Kabir will say, sadhu na chale jamaat. If you have a jamaat around you, you are not a seeker. Believe me, you know. So that's where he will not speak the language of a social activist. He will say that you have to walk that path and alone. And yet he is not going to the Himalayas, right? He's standing in the midst of the public square in the bazaar and saying, come walk with me. But he's insisting on you burning your house before you do it. So that insistence on an individual journey is there, period. And then come walk with me. Then you have tasted something. You have experienced something here through your own dissolution of self or identity. Then come walk with me and we'll walk together. You know? And that irreverence, that anti-establishment spirit in Kabir comes through in the music, for sure it comes through. In fact, Kabir has been sloganized by secular activists in this country for that precise reason, because he challenges the pandit, the qazi, the mullah, who believe in legalistic religion and actually just run a shop that divides. So he does have incredible irreverence and iconoclasm, but not shorn of love. See, and this is again where, you know, I was talking about the lessons I learned coming from a space of activism and continuing to identify with struggles for social change, to know that this iconoclasm or this pulling down or attack on the establishment can come from a place of strength only when you have made a very serious inner journey. There's no compromise. The inner and the outer gaze are equally fierce in Kabir. It cannot be one or the other. And there is a lot of one or the other. You know, there's a lot of selective appropriation of Kabir that happens on both sides. The spiritualists will... What do we have to do with what's happening outside in the world? And the social activists will select the anti-establishment verses of Kabir and really not engage at a deep inner spiritual level. And no shortcuts. Both have to go together, you know. And about the historical time of these poets, it's of course important. But, you know, when you start hanging out with in the oral traditions, you realize that there is a scant regard for history amongst these singers. For instance, a song will bring Meera and Kabir into a dialogue, even though they were centuries apart, or it'll bring... And then if you try and historicize it or make it authentic as per history, you're looked at with a mixture of pity and, you know, like you didn't get the point. And the whole point of it was to let go of the historical Kabir. The whole point of it is to call forth the Kabir in you. And that is what Kabir is in the oral traditions today. The historical figure faded ages back. People own this tradition. They participate in it. They compose their own Kabir songs, and rightfully so, giving contemporary metaphors, because they are participating in a set of ideas that have grabbed the imagination of this country and continue to spread like a fire, you know, or like a virus, I like to say. You know, because you get struck down, chot hoti hai, and then you become infectious, you pass on the, you know. That's what satsangs are, very dangerous places. Yes.
So, I agree with what you mentioned about the historic Kabir, but isn't it amazing that in a period of 300 to 400 years, we had so many of these mystics, you know, starting from Guru Nanak, Kabir, Tulsidas, Surdas, Mirabai, all in a span of 300 to 400 years, preaching the same, giving the same message, and with such, but in different ways. So I think that is the historic relevance, which is quite amazing, I think.
Yes, absolutely. Thank you for pointing that out. And I feel, you know, sometimes when I feel despondent, and we all do sometimes, especially now, I really believe that there is a sort of an underground river flowing in this land that's connecting all of us, and that is the mystic spirit. Because underground rivers have scant regard for borders over the surface of the land. They just breach, no? And this spirit of the Sufis, the Bhaktas, the Bauls, is what is the true spirit of this land. And we all need to bore plumb lines into this underground river and let it burst forth. Let's have a million fountains across this land where people excavate this and let this water our souls, which are getting very dry nowadays.
Question. So, I've made the opposite journey from music to the poetry, and I know your journey has been as a filmmaker than the poetry, and then now you've been journeying as a singer for quite a while. So I'm curious to hear about what the song and singing the song does to inhabiting the space of Kabir, because from my limited practice as a musician, my sense is that singing opens up in a very different way. So I want you to, you know, I'd
yes,
like to
very
share
much.
That.
Thank you for that question, Shruti. I'm not sure I have full answers to this. I think it's significant that the Nirgun path speaks of shabd. Shabd is word, but really shabd is original sound. Sagun is that which you can see. And somehow sight separates, right? I see something, it's outside of me. It's there, I'm here. Sound cannot be appreciated without the dissolution of separation. Sound makes makes us one, right? That is what laya means, lean hona. You cannot experience rhythm without feeling it in your body. You become one with it. I think that's why the Sufis, the Bhaktas and the mystics work with sound as a spiritual practice. Because sound connects, sight divides. As the Kaval from Karachi, Farid Ayaz, says in one place that, you know, gaze is so limited. Wo cheez jo hai, aap usko Allah kahein, kuch bhi kahein, aap in do aankhon se kaise dekh paayenge us reality ko, jiske itne pehlu hain. Our sight is inherently flawed. It is one-sided. But, and he says very charmingly, if you really want to see something, you close your eyes. Because then you feel something in its wholeness, in its totality. And I think sound does that. Sound summons forth some integrative principle in us. Something that connects, that doesn't divide. And which is why in my journeys as a filmmaker, I was itching to drop the camera. You know, the gaze that separated me from the action. You know, and I was dying to pick up the tambura and become one with the sound and feel it in my body. And I think that's what song does. Song activates knowledge centers in the whole body. And we are very reason-oppressed times. In our Cartesian times, we treat our bodies like vehicles to carry this all-important brain around, you know? Because reason and rationality reigns supreme. Whereas the Bhaktas and the mystics are telling us knowledge is in the body. Song activates all those centers of knowledge in the body. So you experience that poem afresh, differently, completely differently. It has taken you places already. It has taken you on inner journeys when you experience it as a song.
What you said is wonderful, but how can this happen when our schooling and our education system is based on only rationality and only reasoning, and there is no place for understanding.
We all have to make it change. We all have to make it change. It's as simple as that. We have to bring other ways of knowing into our schoolrooms. We've been trying. On our website, ajabshahar.org, please visit. It went live this year. We have a section called Classrooms, where we've documented some of the experiments we've done in schools to bring the power of song, poetry, mystic thought, philosophy, creatively into classrooms in out-of-the-box ways. Okay. Yeah. If there are no further questions, we'll end on a song. Yes, yes.
Yeah, please. Sure. Yeah, please. Yeah. But
No, you needed. This okay. is my Buaji.
Okay. You talked a lot about burning your house. Only then we can walk with him, right?
Yes.
Thank you so much. You've given us many, many tips. Thank you. That how to burn that house. If you have any more tip, please give.
Oh my God, that's so difficult. I've just spent 3 years building my house. I'm going back from this festival and in 3 days I move into my new house, you know. That remains to be seen. Yeah, you have to keep that gaze going. You know, how quickly we start setting up shop. You just have to keep that vigilance on yourself. How quickly things we like even become shops. You build and you burn and you dance in that natural rhythm that nature shows you, which is everything that rises will set. Jo uge wo aath mein, phule so kum lae, jo chune wo dahi pade, janme so mari jaye. You have to fall into step with this. And then, as this Buddhist teacher I was listening to, even before it breaks, you will see it coming. You will not be surprised by death. Even as joy is erupting in your life, you will see the pain in it. There. This is why Kabir says, Sadho dekho murdon ka gaon. Because he has that gaze. He's not deluded by happiness. He sees through all these lives. And it's not a despondent poem at all. It's such a wise poem because he knows everything is going, coming, going, going. You know, so if you're going to be wrecked every time something goes, and if you're going to celebrate every time something comes, then avagaman ka chakkar, chakki pising. In do patan ke beech mein sabut bacha na koi. So you have the choice to just flow with the rhythm of nature and delight in the goings as much as you delight in the comings. That's being true to the spirit of Kabir. So build your house and burn it down in the same breath. So this song did float into my planning when I was planning this talk and wondering what to share with you today. It did come because this song also speaks about Milna. A true meeting. And it's a Goraknath bhajan, which I've learned from a wonderful folk singer from Malwa, Kalu Ramji Bamania. Milo re milo koi mhara desra, do do baatan karanga ji. Are koi to mil mere des ka, do do baatein karenge. Lakad lakad sab ek hai, ek hi malik ne ghadhiya ji. This wood, that wood, it's all one wood. One creator made it all. Ek to lakad dhuni mein jale, duji mehlon mein jadiya ji. One log, one wood burns in a bonfire and the other carves is like these beautifully carved pillars in a palace. Pathar pathar sab ek hai, ek hi malik ne ghadiya ji. Ek ki to murat bani, duji pedi mein jadiya ji. This stone, that stone, it's all one stone. One stone was carved into a temple idol, the other the steps leading up to it. Dharti matara chulha kariya, dhua gagan samana ji. चार जुगों के फूंकण दिया धुआं गगन समाना जी धरती माता रा चूल्हा करिया आसमान किया है कढ़ेला जी चार जुगों के फूंकण दिया धुआं गगन समाना जी Now there you have a cryptic verse. The earth, the stove, the pan, the sky. I stoke into the fire all four ages. The smoke rises upwards to the sky. Is he talking about our body? Our life? Are bhai milo re koi mhara desara अरे भाई मिलो रे कोई मारा देसरा दो दो बाता करांगा जी अरे भाई लकड़ सब एक है एक ही मालिक ने घड़ी आजी अरे भाई लकड़ सब एक है एक ही मालिक ने घड़ी आजी अरे भाई एक लकड़ तो धूनी में जले दूजी महलों में जड़ी आजी अरे भाई एक लकड़ तो धूनी में जले दूजी महलों में जड़ी अरे भाई मिलो रे कोई मारा देसरा दो दो बाता करांगा जी अरे भाई पत्थर सब एक है मालिक ने घड़ी आजी अरे भाई पत्थर सब एक है एक ही मालिक ने घड़ी आजी अरे भाई एक पत्थर की मूरत बनी दूजी पेड़ी में जड़िया जी अरे भाई एक पत्थर की मूरत बनी दूजी सीढ़ी में जड़िया अरे भाई मिलो रे कोई मारा देसरा दो दो बाता करांगा जी हाँ हाँ धरती माता रा चूल्हा करिया आसमान किया है कढ़े लाजी हाँ हाँ धरती माथा रा चूल्हा करिया आसमान किया है कढ़े लाजी आहा चार जुगों के फूकन दिया धुआ गगन समाना जी, अरे भाई चार जुगों के फूकण दिया, धुआ गगन समाना जी, अरे भाई मिलो रे कोई भारत देश रा, दो माता करांगा जी। अरे भाई दुई कर जोड़ गो रख बोलिया, पाया है बैकुंठ वासा जी, कर जोड़ गो रख बोलिया, पाया है वैकुंठ वासा जी, अरे भाई जिनने रटिया निज नाम को, संत सुजाना जी, और भाई जिन्हने रटिया निज नाम को, कोई नर संत सुजाना जी, और भाई मिलो रे कोई भारत देश रा, बाकी बाता करांगा जी, यहाँ की बाता करांगा जी। So let us carry this spirit of Milna back into the world in our hearts. This quality of Milna, like Kabir says in Yugana Yugana Ham Yogi, Sabhi Thor Jamaat Hamri, Sabhi Thor Par Mela. Mela, yani Milan. In every place, my people, nobody is other. Sabhi Thor Jamaat Hamri, Sabhi Thor Par Mela. Hum Sab Mai, Sab Hum Mai, Hum Hai Bahuri Akela. So thank you for listening with so much intent heart. Thank you for that. Thank you once again Mumbai Local and Mumbai Festival for creating this evening.